Disclaimer, I love you very much, and your taste in games is valid, even if I disagree with you. So do not fret and walk forward with an open mind and heart. Please don't kill me. Thank you. Sup, nerds? I'm MC Prophet. What are you doing on my fucking property? Well, as long as you're here, let's talk about Bethesda. I have a strange history with this company, because to this day, they've really only made one game that I truly enjoy, Skyrim. I plan on giving Morrowind a fair shot someday, but its gameplay seems pretty archaic. Fallout 3 disappointed me, and Oblivion, well...
I'm getting out of here before it's too late! They'll be here any minute, I'm telling you! Run while you can!
Yeah, that's a topic for a whole nother video. But even in Skyrim, there's always been one consistent problem across all these games, and I'm not talking about the glitches. The problem is balance, especially in Fallout 3. I don't think I'm breaking new ground by saying Bethesda is not very good at balancing complex mechanics and battle systems. Don't get me wrong, their games can still be really engaging. The gameplay in Skyrim and Fallout 4 is smooth and responsive enough, and the sheer variety of things you can do in these games is genuinely fun. But the moment-to-moment gameplay and balance has never been the studio's strong suit. Certain playstyles are always more viable and useful than others, and some of the most powerful playstyles tend to be the most repetitive and boring. You see, I love Skyrim for very specific reasons that don't really revolve around the gameplay. It has an interesting world, complex characters, relationships, and interconnected plot lines, detailed environmental storytelling, conspiracies, mysteries, thought-provoking subtext and all of its little moral conflicts, world-shattering events, ancient ruins, and some of the most fascinating world-building and storytelling ever conceived in gaming. People are still discovering new secrets, new little details, and new creative ways to kill Nazim to this very day. And all of this amazing content is carried by... decent gameplay. It's not exactly the best battle system out there, but it's diverse and rewarding enough to keep my interest while I enjoy the world building that Bethesda really excels at. That's the stuff they're really, really good at conveying. I played over 600 hours of Skyrim before I started modding it, mostly on console before getting a gaming PC. And while it certainly had its issues, I still loved it. Regardless of balancing and mechanical shortcomings, Bethesda has an undeniable talent for conveying an interesting, well-developed world filled with memorable stories and experiences. I like Skyrim for two main reasons. One, an engaging enough diversity of playstyles and ways in which you can approach a problem, and two, a genuinely engaging world to explore. These are the things Bethesda is good at, and for me, Fallout 3 fails in both regards. So yeah, last time I complained about a game being too complicated, this time the game isn't complicated enough. I pride myself on my consistency. But before I dive into the criticism, I just want to clarify something. Because I'm sure that we have a lot of new people here after the Digimon video got 100,000 views. What the actual fuck is YouTube's algorithm? But for anyone new, I'm not here to shame you for your favorite game or make you feel like an idiot for enjoying it. It sucks that I even have to say that, but there's a lot of videos on these topics that thrive on using antagonistic clickbait, and I'm not here to do that. I'm just a guy who spent his entire life studying and making games, and I have a passion for sharing my thoughts on design with other massive nerds who have nothing else better to do. Like you. So if you love this game, good. I'm glad you had a positive experience with it. I'm glad you found some meaning in this cold, dark labyrinth that we call life. But I mean, I fucking hate this thing. So let's talk about why. Ironically, starting on a positive note, our journey begins with what is probably the best part of the intro.
I don't want to set the world on fire.
It's such a simple, minimalistic scene, but it does a phenomenal job setting the tone. The washed-out colors, rust, and broken-down debris conveys the mood of a cold desperation that dominates the entire series. I love how the sound of the radio slowly fades as the camera pans out to reveal the devastated Capital Wasteland. As if the radio, the last shred of familiar civilization, is being drowned out by the hopeless reality of modern-day DC. Not to mention the beautifully ironic lyrics about setting the world on fire. It does a good job at setting the mood, though I wish that Fallout 3 had more than one mood, but we'll talk about that later. So, what's the actual problem with the intro? Well, everything else. Before I ramble about all the problems, I will be fair. There are some interesting subtleties about growing up in the vault. I liked uncovering the patient files your father keeps on his terminal. I liked the foreshadowing of the experiments. I definitely liked the dynamic of the tunnel snakes and watching them grow up. And the not-so-subtle advice of Grandma here. There is some good writing, foreshadowing, and subtlety here, and I think it's important to acknowledge that. But I mean, everything else kinda sucks. No matter what you do, this intro to an open-ended sandbox game never feels like it has any degree of freedom or meaningful player choice. It's a series of hallways with an age gimmick, and you can change about, I don't know, 15 lines of dialogue along the way. There's a pretty cool scene I won't spoil if you let Amata keep the gun, but that's about it. For most players, I think the boredom comes from the drab, restrictive environment with no meaningful decisions or meaningful exploration. And at the same time, your character is constantly jumping forward several years to simulate growing up in the vault. This is a novel concept, but because you're constantly jumping forward, there's no individual moment that really gets enough focus to be fleshed out. And no individual character gets enough development for you to actually care about them. Because of this, it's kind of like the worst of both worlds, because on the one hand, it's long and drawn out because of the repetitive environments, the fairly dull conversations, and the lack of exploration due to how linear it is, which also harms replay value. But simultaneously, it feels like the individual segments are rushed. Nothing feels like it has any impact. No one discusses the aftermath of a situation, and everything goes by so fast, it's like nothing ever happened. You fight Butch, there's two lines of dialogue, and then it's over. You fight the Tunnel Snakes, there's one line of dialogue, and then it's over. You kill someone in cold blood at the age of 19 for the first time? Eh, whatever. It feels like you never get to experience being a kid, or a teen, or really even a vault dweller at all. It feels like you're getting a guided tour through a vault-themed amusement park. And at any given moment, the only thing I want to do is hop off the frickin' tour bus and go exploring. I want to go open all those restricted doors. I want to uncover conspiracies. I want to see if there's some kind of resistance to the oppressive regime of the Overseer. I want to team up with Amata as kids and go exploring somewhere we're not supposed to go and then get brutally punished by the Overseer. So there's some real, genuine buildup as to how cruel and mad with power this character is. I want to feel how oppressive and restrictive the society is for myself through examples of this oppression actually happening, build up a relationship with a character that I really care about, and then show me that person being cut down or unjustly accused and oppressed by this regime, as opposed to just being told about oppression through a few suggestive text boxes. And then when you turn 19, everyone suddenly goes crazy because I guess it's time for the plot to start. And on that note, I want some kind of buildup as to why almost everyone in the vault is instantly willing to murder their 19-year-old neighbor because her dad opened a fucking door! But most importantly, I want to bust a cap in Butch's ass with a BB gun when you're a kid. And invent a shrink ray. Yeah, maybe that's asking too much, I don't know. Because of this, the intro not only feels slow and drawn out, but its individual moments feel rushed and lack emotional impact. All of this is made worse by the fact that not only is the player barely playing the game in terms of combat or exploration, they're also barely contributing to the story, since their dialogue choices have such little impact. Once again, it's effectively the worst of both worlds. Fallout 3's intro is often dismissed as one of its most glaring flaws, but I wouldn't go that far. From a narrative perspective, it serves its purpose pretty damn well. It establishes the lore, helps the player form connections with some characters, and so forth. It has a lot of smaller issues, but here's the big one. The intro belongs in a totally different game. And now, because the internet loves arbitrary lists, here are my major issues with Fallout 3's early game. 1. It barely introduces any of the game's skills. Like fucking any of them. Think about your arsenal during the escape from the vault. You get one gun, two melee weapons, and your bare hands. That's it. This intro takes 45 minutes to complete, and it barely introduces 4 of the 13 skills. No explosives, no laser weapons, no heavy weapons, and little to no indication that skills like science, lockpicking, or repair will be particularly useful. Speech, small guns, and maybe sneak are the only skills that the player is going to have much meaningful exposure to by the time they leave the vault. The game does generously allow the player to customize their starting stats at the end of the prologue, and then immediately gives you your first level up to further customize your character. But really think about this situation for a second. How much do you really know about what skills you want to invest points in right now? You've been exposed to, like, 3 skills. Are laser weapons useful? I don't know. Explosives? Big guns? How would you know? You haven't seen a single one of them. Say what you will about Skyrim's opening, it gets incredibly annoying on your 10th playthrough. Though I guess any intro would. But at least in that game's opening, you have the opportunity to try out practically every non-crafting skill. There's a few magic schools that are left out, but that's about it. You can start with good equipment for mages, light armor, heavy armor, examples of just about every kind of weapon, shields, you start with at least 2 spells, you learn how to lockpick, sneak, use bows. From a tutorial standpoint, this is honestly a great introduction, and it stands in stark contrast to the restrictive nature of Fallout's intro. You haven't sampled any of these skills, and yet you're expected to already be making permanent investments in them like you know what the hell you're doing. At this point in the game, I don't even know what an energy weapon looks like. This all connects to another problem with the early game in general. Problem 2. Weapon variety. This is an overarching issue. Small guns and their ammo are the most readily available type of weapon by far. And while that might make sense from a lore perspective, it's a pretty awful decision in terms of gameplay. You have to go to some very specific areas to get so much as a laser pistol in the early game, and while energy weapons gradually become less rare, they never really get common, and they simply lack the variety offered by heavy weapons and small guns. Of course, the problem with heavy weapons is that they're effectively locked until the mid to late game. Even super mutants will just be toting hunting rifles and melee weapons at lower levels most of the time. So the beginning of almost every character you play feels exactly the same. Regardless of whether or not you specialize in small guns, you're gonna have to deal with using them anyway. Yes, you can use melee weapons, but they're essentially a gimmick playstyle that revolves around taking more damage and dealing less damage for no real benefit, aside from not consuming ammo, I guess. You can do it, but the game basically doesn't want you to. Most enemies deal a lot of ranged damage, and by the time you track them down and reach melee range, you've taken a lot of unnecessary hits. Plus, with melee vats, you can't target specific body parts, which greatly limits your strategic options. You can't purposely cripple limbs or heads or anything like that. Aside from the convenience of not needing ammo, I really can't think of any advantage to using melee weapons in the early game. Another skill, explosives, are very powerful, but explosives are very rare at the beginning of a playthrough, so you're going to have a tough time focusing on anything but small guns for the first few hours of the game. And this is why balance is so important, because when one option is more convenient, more reliable, and has a wider variety of weapon types, why would you bother with the other options? It's effectively limiting the playstyle and variety of the game in what's supposed to be an open-ended RPG. You know, with character customization and different ways to solve problems. I feel like there's this weird expectation to start with small guns, then add energy and heavy weapons by the end of a playthrough. So once again, as far as combat is concerned, most builds end up being very familiar and similar, unless you're going out of your way to do a melee build or something really specific. That's not even a problem that's unique to the opening of the game, it's a consistent issue. Energy weapons only feel slightly different than their ballistic counterparts, so it's not like they offer a drastically different playstyle. And until you're in the mid-game, it's basically impossible to find enough ammo to use heavy weapons as a primary damage source. When a playstyle isn't viable at the beginning of the game, or even part of the mid-game, it's gonna be hard for a player to justify pumping a lot of points into that skill when they're about to finish the fucking playthrough. Thus, by the time they have enough heavy weapon ammo or explosives, it doesn't feel worth it to use them unless they start specking into a skill in the late game. Of course, you could exploit the design flaw to get as many skill-ups as you could possibly ever want, but that's kind of another balancing issue altogether. In fact, that leads directly to problem number 3. Intelligence is way too important compared to the other special stats. I'm pretty sure that a lot of people who like this game have already started commenting something to the effect of, well, intelligence can undo a lot of these problems. Yeah, I guess it can, but intelligence in and of itself is kind of a problem. You see, the intelligence stat effectively makes every single one of your skills and every aspect of your playstyle better. Literally, regardless of what you're doing, intelligence is going to make you better. This is because the higher your intelligence stat, the more skill points you gain upon level up. The other special stats only affect a small selection of skills, but because of the connection to the skill points, intelligence effectively boosts all of them, making it such a powerful stat that it's effectively better than literally every other special stat. The special stats were never going to be perfectly balanced, that's not really what I'm complaining about. It's just the fact that intelligence is so ludicrously more important than any other stat, and I don't know, if you're even slightly invested in min-maxing and getting the most out of a playthrough, you're probably gonna raise your intelligence a lot, regardless of your build, regardless of your roleplay, regardless of your playstyle. And that just, again, kinda limits your options. Once again, this is why balance is so important. Because when a game is balanced around several different kinds of playstyles, new playthroughs are less repetitive, and different kinds of playstyles are encouraged. And finally, and perhaps most significantly, we have the main reason why I said this intro belongs in a totally different game. Problem number 4, you have a completely predetermined backstory. Now, I'm sure that doesn't sound like a big deal at first, and I know it's not a deal-breaker for a lot of people, but this is a Bethesda game, an open-ended RPG, a game that's supposed to revolve around player decisions and role-playing. And no matter how you want to play the game, you'll always start as a 19-year-old kid who just stepped out of the vault for the first time looking for your dad. And this scrawny teenage recluse will be blasting the heads off super mutants within 5 days of holding their first real gun. Immersive. Now, it's not quite as restrictive as Fallout 4's intro, but this opening still leaves very little up to the player. Your family, backstory, life experiences, and age are all predetermined and set in stone. You can't play as an older character, you can't play as a combat veteran, a thief on the run, or a wandering medic helping out those in need. You'll always have the same backstory with a few minor details shifted around, and you'll always start from the same square one. Again, I'm sure that this isn't a big deal for a lot of people, a lot of people probably don't even notice this. But this restrictive backstory is one of the main reasons I, and a lot of other people, hate replaying Fallout 3. Combine that with the repetitive play styles and the linear opening, and starting a new character feels like a chore. And for a series that's trying to promote its open-endedness and replay value, it's just not a good fit. This intro, while not horrible, just doesn't suit a game like Fallout 3. You can easily enjoy a game that's not properly balanced, especially if you don't plan on making multiple playthroughs, but every time I boot up Fallout 3, all I see is wasted potential. I see a world that could have been far more interesting. I see a system that could have had more variety and depth, and I see an intro that feels like it belongs in a totally different game. As I said before, if you liked this game, good. There's a lot to love, despite all the things I just rambled about for 20 minutes. And if you like this game, you don't have to justify it or feel like an idiot. I just wanted to explain how I, and a lot of other people, felt the first time we walked into the Capital Wasteland. Critique serves as a way to improve, study, appreciate, and contextualize the media we consume. And that's all I want to do here. I happen to hate this game, but it still charmed quite a few people, so it must be doing something, right? I don't know what that something is, but something. And assuming people aren't already incredibly pissed at me for making this one, I might make a follow-up video addressing the overarching issues of Fallout 3, including the story and whether or not Bethesda improved upon these issues in further games. So if that sounds interesting to you, let me know. If you enjoy hearing my thoughts on design, consider subscribing and supporting my little shit show on Patreon. Otherwise, I'll starve to death. I also stream pretty frequently on Twitch when I'm not ridiculously busy like I have been this past month. So until next time, I'm MC Prophet, and my opinion is the best one, so fuck you!
Let's go sunning, it's so good for you. Let's go sunning, 'neath the sky of blue. Greet the sun every morn, feel as free and happy as the day you were born.